once again, welcome to Shifting Tides. And today I'm most excited to introduce my very dear friend, Laurence de la Baume from France. Her story, her extraordinary story, is nothing short of being magical. So I welcome Laurence. Hello, Laurence.
Hello, Mahiema. I'm very shy now. You just told too many great things. I'm
Don't
not worth it.
Don't have to be. Don't have to be. You're an extraordinary person, so don't have to be. Okay, so before we start, Laurence, very briefly, I'd like to introduce you in your own words. Who is Laurence today?
Oh, today Laurence is, an ex-journalist, an author, and a grandmother.
Brilliant.
Anti-grandmother.
Brilliant, brilliant. And tell me, what does Shifting Tides as a title, what does Shifting Tides imply to you? I mean, first of all, thank you. Thank you for agreeing to participate in this show. I'm most honored and excited.
Thank
you. So what does Shifting Tides imply to you?
I think that it implies that nothing is there forever. That unexpected is always a disruption or an overwhelming of what we considered as established before. For instance, we can call we can say that reality is much, much larger, this unexpected can have the power of resetting our minds. You know, so we have to live this unexpected as a constant in our lives, which constrains us to be much more awakened than we are usually. This new state of mind, it builds a kind of new curiosity, a constant alert or lookout of our lives, and an empathy for the others, and a much more exciting way of living. We are transformed into an active observer of our lives and for the other. Maybe this is all together. So this is very interesting, I mean, to have entitled your interviews like this, because it can integrate every kind of personal experiences which have overwhelmed one's life. So it's,
exactly.
You see,
exactly.
I'm not, my English is not enough precise sometimes. I must excuse myself. I mean,
yes, but it's perfectly understandable. Perfectly understandable. Yes. You've had an amazing experience. How many years ago was that?
24 years old.
Yes.
24 years ago. Sorry.
Yes. So that obviously had overwhelmed you. One, I would really like you to narrate that amazing, profound experience you had. And also, what did that do to you in terms of an overwhelm? Because these experiences are not just, by the way, everyday kind of an experience. It's something that shakes your reality, that shakes your world. So what exactly happened? I'd really like you to narrate that episode.
I would divide your question in two parts.
Yes.
What really happened, and then what it changed, because first of all, what happened, I couldn't imagine that what happened was could even one day my life happen. I have never imagined that before. It was during an interview for ARTE channel with an author, Australian author, whose name was Madru, And I was talking about you know, being a writer, what was it, etc. And I suddenly, I was asking the banal question, why do you write? And he said, I don't write. My ancestors are writing through me. So for me, it was the first surprise. And I said, okay, tell me, how do you do that? And he said, I'm connecting with them twice a day. And it's during the dream time, what we call Aboriginal dream time. So I, at that time, so, oh my God, I'm not in front of just a writer. I'm in front of a kind of shaman. And so I asked him, can you give me your dream time? And he suddenly had an extraordinary shout, a kind of magical sound, which emerged from, I would say, from the ground through him completely. And it was so extraordinary to hear, so unimaginably before, that I had a very strange face, because I didn't expect this. And the air between us seemed to change. So it was like a kind of a gas. The air became like a gas. So I was very, you know, very, very surprised, more than surprised. And suddenly he stopped and said, I'm just a man from Australia, and bursted out in laugh. And I couldn't even finish the interview, and it was filmed. So I had a very special moment at this time. Felt very, you know, uncomfortable and completely fulfilled at the same time. So when we met, when the interview was over, I just thanked him for all what he gave us, Western public. And he said to me, oh, now we're connected to you. And I thought it was like, you know, hi, let's keep in touch. I didn't know it was, but I remembered that I had an extraordinary impression, and the air just, you know, changed. So something has been very weird at that time between us. So when I came back, I was completely full of an energy, very beautiful and positive energy. Oh my God, the Aboriginal are so close to us, we're so close to each other, etc. And when I came home, this energy completely disappeared, and I felt like so incredibly tired, like, you know, like I've never been before, or just after giving birth with my children, or something like this. So I went immediately to the bed and tried to sleep. And at around 2 a.m., I woke up with a very strange and uncomfortable impression that I had a kind of, you know, how can I say that? I felt very dizzy, very as if I had eaten something bad, or I had eaten or drunk or whatever, and suddenly something began to turn in me. So it was not normal, kind of centrifugal force began to turn. So I began to panic, because the walls around me just were not like before, etc. And I completely panicked, and I couldn't explain. So I thought, I'm getting crazy. I have to find someone who can take care of my children, because tomorrow I won't be able to do, to put them in school, etc. So it was 2 a.m. In the morning. And I remembered just one telephone call, and I did it completely automatically without understanding, and a friend of mine who is a neighbor answered, which is a miracle already, and said, don't worry, it can be, or it must be, your shaman this afternoon because I had met him to explain.
Wow. Yeah.
And at that moment, he said, don't be scared. It must be a present. But, you know, I had never, so it was a present. So when he said it's only a present, I rang off and said, okay, let's try to not to be so feared.
So present and as a gift. Present as of a gift.
Take it as a gift.
Okay.
Exactly what he said. So I just, at that time, tried to give up this fear. And these centrifugal forces increased. And I completely, I have been ejected from my body. And through a tunnel, a dark tunnel, and suddenly I was like a particle or a photon, let's say what you want. I mean, in an orbit with my body very, very small, being very small, miles and miles away, I couldn't see it anymore. And I was in an extraordinary state, a state of happiness and of joy, which has never been before in my life. A state of, I don't know if it exists in English, but a plenitude. I don't know if it's a kind of complete wholeness. Well, wholeness, an extraordinary wholeness. And I don't know how long it lasted. What happened was that suddenly I felt the gravity forces obliging, constraining the body to the soul. I don't know what, maybe, I suppose it was the soul to come inside, back inside the body and to re-enter the body. And I came back into the body and opened the eyes and everything was back to the normal. But it was, I had an energy that I had never had before, an energy I remember that I wanted to run and kiss everyone in Paris, and it was a completely crazy moment because you're in the middle of a night and suddenly you want to shout and shout of joy, of happiness.
Like an ecstatic moment.
Completely ecstatic moment. So, and then I had to sleep back. So I tried my best, etc. And in the morning, I could do all the thing normal with my children. And suddenly it re-begin. I felt the same processes, the same. But this time I wasn't scared anymore. So I could, at that time, I could register very, very precisely what happened. And I could write it back as soon as I came back to the body to explain what is, that first of all, what happened, how we enter a body, how our soul enters a body when we are incarnating, etc. And it was such an extraordinary joy that the first thing was that I wanted to call my mother and to say, don't fear any more death. Never, don't be scared anymore of death.
Okay.
And etc. It's just another state of mind. So this is the first resetting.
So where did that resetting, now that it happened so many years ago, where do you feel that resetting came from? In your logical mind, what did you make of it? How did you process it?
First of all, I thought, because, you know, all these are impressions. All these are, I haven't left my body in reality, but these are impressions. So I had the impression that I have a whole resetting, a whole new vision of life. First of all, that everything which I, first of all, concerned me as very important were completely details. That we were not attuned to the real important things in life, which are only love, only joy, only love, joy, happiness. We are made, our cells are made for that. But at that time, I couldn't. It was before I had done this enormous quest with scientists. So I said, you know, I thought, I can't tell anything. I won't be credible. I have to give this to be scrutinized by science. And this changed my life, because this quest lasted 15 years. And I could explain little by little all these extraordinary paths. What happened at that time was a real thing for some scientists, and especially quantum physicists, who could explain or had elements of information that could corroborate these kind of effects on one's mind, on one's psychological experience. So it was pretty interesting. It was extraordinary, and that's that was my the way I built the book I wrote after having met all these scientists, not to be taken as a, you know, a crazy person, because I didn't know that all these could exist before. I hadn't any idea about that. Vision, yeah. Reality for me is what I was looking at, what I was feeling, what I was, you know. But now I know that reality is completely different, that we can influence reality, and because we can, it depends on what we feel inside. When we feel very much aligned with our core self, with our, let's talk about soul, or I don't know how, because it can, you can say it in many, many ways. When you are aligned with your soul, you have a permanent joy inside joy, which can drives you to the main meaning of your life, which accompanies you to the meaning of your life. I don't know if I'm very clear.
Yes. No. It does make sense. Two questions come up while you're speaking. One is, looking back in hindsight, why do you think you were chosen for this experience?
I think it's just because the shaman was, he didn't expect a journalist, a French journalist, to be, I suppose, to be as a child. Because, you know, for me, when I came to him and he was being interviewed by very famous journalists, etc., who were talking about his impression about France and etc., I thought, there is something artificial in this. This is not him. He represents a very, very ancient population, one of the most meaningful population in our world, because who are the most important people in the world or today?
Yeah,
this is there are all these ancient populations with their knowledge, what we call stupidly primitive, which is stupid. It's primary. It's extraordinary. They have a real insight, a real connection to the nature, to the main nature, and they have to be our teachers. So that's why I told him, talk to me as if I was a child, a 5 years old child, because French, we are 5 years old children, being pretentious, but we are children. Yes. And he was so amazed by this, I suppose, behavior. He was not, so he gave me his heart, I mean, in this sense. And that's why, and he talked to me as a teacher, and from his connections with his ancestors, And it was not only a gift for me, but it was a gift to the public, because he knew that as a journalist, I can't take it for myself. I'm a journalist, so I'm a person who's used to communicate. So yes. I had to communicate this, and that's, I think, why he chose me. He said, nobody's crazy as her to understand that at this point.
Yeah. So did you have any background of science before this, or did it start coming to you as tapping that information from the universe later?
Later. I was very bad in mathematics. I was very not prepared, in science. I hated science usually. I mean, as you know, it's a childish behavior. And then I don't know why I was able to understand quantum physics, to understand not mathematics, because I'm very bad still, but everything was clear. I didn't have problem to cope, to collaborate with, for instance, afterwards I had this extraordinary privilege to meet the Nobel Prize in Physics, the astrophysicist George Smoot, with whom I collaborated more than 2 years as a head of his communication for the mission in Russia. So normally I shouldn't have been, you know, I wasn't prepared, but it was so extraordinary. It's like what he was telling me was completely related to what I had experienced inside my body. And I all these processes with gravity, with speed of light, because I could explain then in scientific terms what happened to me. Now I'm able to do it with scientific terms. Before I wasn't. So it was an extraordinary school, an extraordinary university to work with him after, to work with different physicists, to work with even with biologists, with cardiologists, with all kinds of scientific areas. And each time,
go on.
No, each time I just noticed that they were very happy people. That they, especially between, they were people very joyful. So maybe they didn't know why, but they were so passionate in their things. And so I don't know how.
So tell me, in one way, I feel that you reached a point after that experience when you started accessing information which you were unfamiliar with before that.
Yes, exactly.
Right? Which means that that information, as I was speaking with Professor Laszlo, that information is already there.
Absolutely.
And we don't have the capacity and the capability to access it unless and until we are beaten down by the universe.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly. That's precisely that. He's funny because he said, you have to have a good telephone and be connected by the good number.
Exactly.
You see the good. And I think these kinds of experiences, not only mine, but lots of experiences, personal, they can be even very serious diseases, traumas or accidents or many things, very horrible things, very dramatic situations in life are not, I would say, kind of devices to oblige us to see things in another way. They are here to make us higher, you see, in ourselves, to see things from another dimension, to be connected to our higher consciousness, to our higher possibilities.
Yes, yes.
And it opens, it is a real resetting of mind and brain and heart completely.
Yeah, yeah. Like in Autobiography of a Yogi, there is a beautiful saying that a crisis or a calamity is usually a doorway to an opportunity.
Exactly. And people don't know, because they don't know how important it is to be aligned with one's soul, with our core self. They can reach it with when they are believers, through prayers, if they are really believers, or through meditation, or yeah, through different, you know, ways. And it's so incredibly important to find this extraordinary dimension with which enlarges us, and which is very calm, and which is like a dimension where nothing can happen to you. You're safe, completely safe. You see, so when you have this, once you can have it back to your mind, and you can exercise even with this, because every day you can exercise with this, trying to have a kind of meeting with yourself, even for a few minutes in your day life, to remember this, to put, it's like remembering a wonderful moment in your life where you were in a happiness and so totally fulfilled and totally peaceful. You can have it every day. Put it into your consciousness during the day, many times as you need, and your body will ask you to do it. Then it's an exercise which becomes a nature, and you're more empathic with the others, because this is the consequences. You're so, you know that you are so united to people. You are one with people. You're not separated with them.
So in your 24 years of exploring this domain, was there any one moment of real awe when you were taken aback? Of course, lots of things that appeared which made you write the books you've written. Everything was new to you, but that one special thing that really stepped up, gave you a quantum jump in your learnings or in your search, in your seeking. Was there that one thing that really gave you that feeling of awe?
When you think of someone you love, or you, let's say you love, or you think of him or her, and suddenly he calls you immediately.
Yes.
You have this immediate impression that there is something magical, and this magic is real, and you can make things being magical. I mean, by your own behavior, by your own need of connecting with people, with others, being happy. So you don't need a haha moment special. You have out of body experience I had, which, you know, overwhelmed my life. But since then, all these synchronicities, magical moments, extraordinary surprise of life, etc., have been always in my life, non-stop, and creating a kind of a whole family. We are a whole family, we human beings. We should be a whole family together. We should behave like ourselves in our body, which are all connected to coherence, to the highest level of coherence, to create a completely healthy body. So they are all non-stop trying to see what empathically, I would say,
yeah,
to see what, how to collaborate, how to be the most excited and happy together. So if we begin to imitate what's going on inside with our own cells, we can have a kind of plan to materialize in our lives.
Yeah.
You see, we have a plan because the connections are there. We can help others. They can help us. We're all parts of a huge body, which has a spiritual origin, and this spiritual origin came before our incarnation. We are energies before being material.
Yes.
That's an extraordinary element to take, you know, into consideration, because you know that before you were a particle or a photon or an energy, and then you embodied your soul, who is a group of information, embodied your body and became who you are. So that's already very excited, and that imitating the nature with a great N should be our first concern.
Yeah.
See what happens. You see,
yeah,
even when obstacles are there.
Yeah.
See what obstacles. What does it? How does it resonate in to me? What does it mean to me, to my core self? You know, this resonance,
yeah,
is,
yeah,
why did I attract this? Why did I attract this? It's important, because then you understand that this is not your neighbor is not responsible for what happened to you, or your mother, or your children, or your, of course there can be responsibilities, but they are, at least you understand that everything has to be is a lesson, is a way of knowledge to you, to be more, to be higher, to be more empowered in yourself, to be, you see what I mean? I'm not sure I'm very clear always.
No, you are.
Because we are tools for each other, and this is important to know. Even with people who are very, let's say, bad people, or they're not bad, they have a suffering somewhere which resonates with you, and you have to understand something from them, etc., etc.
True.
So when you understand this relationship between you and the others, you understand your responsibility for yourself. You understand? You have
So how do you relate? How do you relate this information to present times, what the world is going through with COVID?
With
COVID.
COVID. Ah.
Yeah.
Oh, that COVID is a very good lesson. I'm sorry to say that, but I see just this. Of course, it's a horrible situation for many people, and I don't negate this. But we have produced this COVID situation in some ways. Our way of consuming, of treating beasts, animals, of treating the others, of wanting always the consumer posture, I would say, have driven us to this, and so we are partly responsible for what's going on. Even pandemias, they are being given for us to increase our higher self, to, yeah, develop ourselves, to be more respectful to people and to ourselves and to our environment and to animals and to plants, to understand that we are just a very small cell in the universe, you see? So that's, we shouldn't fear. We shouldn't fear And if we shouldn't believe all this confusion which is around us. So that means to understand that we could have a new way of perception, to perceive we are all surrounded by informations, bad informations, negative, fearful informations, but we have the power to take this information and seeing it at a distance and catch it and see, I don't want it to get inside because it's not, it doesn't resonate. I'm not concerned, just intimately. You know, we have the power of taking the information, observing them as active observers, which doesn't mean we are indifferent, but which means we have to be careful with the information we perceive. What does it create in me? So I have the possibility with my will, to refuse the information, not to take it, enter into my nervous system, you see, which then creates fears, confusions, emotions, etc. We have the power of handling our emotions today. Yeah. And that's our responsibility to be the not the master, but to try to handle our emotions and see just to segregate and see the best, the one who are the most positive for us. And because you know that our beliefs have influence on our genes today. So we have, this is very important. Yes. The emotions have an enormous impact on our genes. So we have the possibility of not repeating the destructive patterns that we had learned for centuries. You see,
as a part of our condition,
we can change. We can open new areas. We can open new genes. So our beliefs are very important, and our emotions are very important today. To be careful in the perception of information, to be more wise, I would say. Towards the information, not to take everything for granted.
Yeah.
You see what I mean? Yeah. Oh, they fear, so I'm fearing. No. You see what I mean? This is very important because it looks very easy, but it's not easy. It's a whole process of considering information, seeing, putting it at a certain distance before it enters. You see what I try to say?
True. What we missed out on getting from you is, after that experience 24 years ago, you got down to meeting scientists and physicists and cardiologists and a whole gamut of such people. So that information was obviously put down in your books.
Yeah.
What was the first book you wrote? And in the series of so many years, what are the other books you've written? If you just in brief, if you can tell us something about your books.
The book you're referring to is not my first book. It was I first wrote a book, a novel, a political novel when I was 25. It was about Poland. Then I had a book about Satprem, which was the name was Satprem, l'homme de l'espoir. Which was published in 2003. But at that time, so I was in the course of the comprehension of what happened with my out-of-body experience, which was in 1996. So the book you're referring to is the third one, which is Va par où tu ne sais pas, which explains all what I told you from the experience, from this out-of-body experience to the quest, to the scientific quest. And then now I'm finishing a book which is just on the heart, which is in the French title is La Contagion du Cœur. I don't know, in English, I'm not sure it's a good title, but in English it's The Heart Contagion, because I wanted to use a word which is a very negative word, contagion. We are in the virus period, virus yeah. time, yes. contagion. We're all afraid of contagion, but yes. We are afraid of contagion of the heart. We yes. need to open our hearts, otherwise we will kill each other, you see? Yeah. So that's very important to know that. And this is the second part of the same quest, but more centered on the heart and this extraordinary power of the heart yeah. that we have and that we don't know yet. We don't know how much powerful is our heart. We don't know how much powerful is the opening of our heart in our lives and for us all to create a new society of really a society completely yeah. different, completely the society, a kind of integral democracy, something very, very positive. But we have to find this, to discuss this, and this is just by the opening of the heart that we can introduce the these elements and the conversations and the, yeah. The planning to elaborate this new society.
Yeah.
I'm thinking especially of the new generations who are all, you know, emerge in this obligation of finding a new way, a new democracy, a new way of living together, much more collaborative, much more integrative.
That's true. So with that work, do you see hope in the world, hope in our society, in our environment, of coming or emerging in a new age, emerging in a world which is better than what we've left behind? Do you see that hope?
If I wouldn't have this hope, I wouldn't be here to talk to you. I wouldn't be spending all my time writing and trying to give, you know, conferences to open people's hearts. I think it's very important to do that. There is an enormous hope today, enormous as the drama who's going on the other level.
On the other,
you see, on the you have two levels of always seeing reality, or as a drama, or as an extraordinary path to a new yeah. and very 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 beautiful
yeah,
moment,
yeah.
very happy moment. I'm not sure. I mean, I'm not able to say when it will happen, but I think that there will be a critic mass when a certain number of people will repeat all these things, each with his own language, and it will resonate, and it will suddenly make a huge shift in the world.
Yeah.
And absolutely, that's cultural. It's based on emotions.
Yes,
and of course that's based on the heart.
Yes,
and that's why
the whole idea of even presenting Shifting Tides to the world. You know, the whole idea is to be able to connect everybody and see that we are all one, boundaryless, culturalless, just all of us are connected at a very, very deep level. So
exactly.
just to conclude, Laurence, I'd like to ask you one question. Is that one thing is very clear, that when we are given this slap on our back by the universe or divine or source, whatever you may call. It's like a time for call to action. It's a call to action. And that time comes in everybody's life in some form or the other, you know, whether it's a war trauma or it's a disease or it's losing a loved one or it's breaking up of a relationship or it's, you know, financial loss. It could be anything. What is that one advice you would like to give to people to not suck in into that drama of that calamity and to rise from there and to rise and be able to understand or see through that darkness to walk into light? What is that one advice you'd like to give? Because most people succumb to that tragedy or that pitfall or that bad time. You know, they succumb to it, and some people even commit suicide. They can't take it. Or some people take to drugs, or some people go into alcohol, or some people just get into depression. They just can't get out of it. But that actually is their moment of opportunity. So what is, yeah. I'd really like to, you know, give an advice to our youngsters, especially to our youth. Yes. You know, what can they do?
First of all, I think to connect with themselves. Connect with us themselves means to connect with their soul, with their, so it's not easy to do. It's just to remember maybe the most marvelous moments in their lives where maybe love at a certain moment happened to be lived by them. Love. Maybe they had a mother who loved them. Maybe they had, I don't know. Each one has a moment, a very important moment in which he has been or she has been, I think, I can say happy, maybe happy is just a too large word, but there are these moments to try to remember these moments and to reconnect with them, because it helps reconnect it with the emotion that is embodied, that has been experienced inside. And when you remember something, you re-experience something. Yeah. So okay. you build a new frequency in your body. All these rebuilding frequencies, higher frequencies in your body through love or through extraordinary moments of freedom, of I think it can be whatever, you know, they want, but each of us has such moments or such a moment. So it can be, I think, the best recommendation when you see babies, very small babies, they are very joyful. I mean, there is a simplicity to connect with inside. Yes. What makes me happy today? What makes me just to live, to be alive? I'm just alive and I can talk to you, and this is extraordinary already, but nobody understands how extraordinary it is. True. They just understand that when their brother die, or when there is or when they have a disease, yeah, or when they have a depression. No, I don't want to die. We are alive, and we are made for loving. Our body are made for loving. Our cells are made for love and cooperation. Absolutely. Remember that. That's very important.
Yes.
Inside, what is inside you is outside. Become what you see outside yourself. When you're in a good position, when you're serene, when you're calm, you have people, everything is clearer for you. People are well in your presence. So try to connect with who they are really, not what they have been told to be, not what the influences of, you know, their surroundings are making of them. No way, no way. My resonance, I'm a laboratory. I'm my own laboratory. And I'm doing this for myself. What makes me happy? What makes you happy will not be what makes me happy, etc. Try to find really who you are and to feel how much alive and how much a loving person you are for yourself and for the others.
True.
That's very banal, but I don't see anything else to say, you see.
Brilliant.
No, it's...
brilliant. Thank you so much, Laurence. That was such an enlightening talk.
Thank you, Mahiema.
Such an enlightening, uplifting.
You are an enlightening person. Oh, go ahead.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Love you.
Bye-bye.
So that brings us to an end of our today's episode, to this most enlightening and uplifting episode. I would like to add that whenever we all go through calamities, we all go through hard times, we all have problems and obstacles, never give up. Rise and look into the bigger picture and see that at the end of that darkness, there is light. So all the best. Wish you very best for the next week and see you next weekend. Bye-bye.